Matthew chapter 21, verse
to 46. Sometimes when we're talking to someone, we get the sense that they just aren't getting what we're saying. You see the blank look on the face or the eyes slowly glazing over. And so we have to make a decision, don't we? Either just give up and let it go. Or if the information we need to impart is really important, we try to word it differently so that they can grasp it in a different way. And with the kids, even now they're both adults, it sometimes means getting very creative. And with my husband, well, least said, soonest mended about that. Now, these last verses of Matthew chapter 21 are a fuller explanation of the things that we looked at last week, as Jesus pronounces judgment on the unbelieving chief priests and elders of Israel. Now, if you look back to the start of the chapter, you'll remember that that chapter began by showing us exactly who Jesus is, the King who comes in the name of the Lord. And the picture is a familiar but a very powerful one. Jesus on the back of the donkey, riding into Jerusalem to the shouts and cheers of the crowds, palm branches and cloaks being laid on the ground before him. He is the King coming to rule. And it's vital that we begin by remembering that important fact. Jesus is God's King, the one foretold by Scripture, the one with a right to rule. Of course, as we look more closely, we see that he is the King, but he's a King like no other. Not on a war horse, but a donkey. Not in a military parade, but to the cheers of children. Not a procession to his throne room, but a visit to the throne room of God, the temple. And his priority was never for his own power, but for God's kingdom to be established. And that is still Jesus's priority. Now, of course, when Jesus got to the temple, he found a hubbub, didn't he? Doves cooing, lambs bleating, coins jangling. What was being sold to the people as true and pure worship of God was nothing more than a money-making exercise to support the lifestyles of the most wealthy. And Jesus was angry. In John's Gospel, we're told he made a whip out of cords and chased the money changers and sellers out. Matthew's a little bit briefer and just tells us that he overturned the tables on them. It's judgment on practices which purport to be worship, but were anything but. In our own day, we need to be careful that it is God that we are honouring the things that we do here in church and in our lives. There's many ways that we can shift the focus. It can become about the drama of the service, or the tastiness of the coffee, the bums on pews to pay the parish share, rather than the worship of God. But Jesus, as we've been seeing, is far more interested in fruitfulness, lives lived for him that make a difference. He looked for fruit in the temple. He didn't find any. And the cursing of the fig tree in verse 19 was a worked parable of what was going to happen to them. And in its context there, it's clearly about the Jewish leaders. But as we bring it all forward into our own day, we find some sobering lessons for ourselves too. The first one is Jesus rejects those who reject his authority. Verse 23 gives us the context for today's reading. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him. By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? It's not a question from the heart like a seeker makes. It's a challenge. They're placing themselves as people who know better than God. I wonder if we ever make that mistake ourselves. Perhaps when we read the scriptures and we say, well, that can't be right. Jesus wouldn't say that. But do you know, that's saying that we know better than him. That's challenging Jesus' authority. And here Jesus has got no interest in engaging in a discussion when all the evidence has been apparent in everything that he's been doing. And so he doesn't directly answer their question. He cuts them off. But of course, he does tell us two parables. Second thing to learn is Jesus is not interested in those who say the right things but don't mean them. This was last week's little bit, wasn't it? Remember the parable of the two sons in the vineyard. Both sons were asked to go and work there. The first said, I won't go, disobeying his father. But then he repented and went. The other son said all the right things. I will go, sir. Respectful, obedient. Except he didn't go. His respect and his obedient words were just a veneer. Just like the fancy words and the actions of the chief priests and the elders, looking obedient to God, but actually leading the people astray. Jesus has stern words for them. Verse 31, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. Do you know, it's easy for us to look at the ancient people of God and point the finger, condemn. But could we be accused of playing the part of being a Christian? Do we just say the right words here in church and then go away and forget all about them? Do we follow Jesus from the heart? Third thing to note is Jesus' patience will not last forever. This is today's passage. And also, of course, it was the theme, those of you who were in church on Sunday, that we saw in Judges, when the people had turned away so many times, he said, I'm not going to save you this time. Well, today's passage starts with a very familiar biblical image, that of the vineyard, verse 33. There was an owner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a wine press, and built a watchtower. So this is a vineyard that's well cared for, it's well protected, and it's watched over. Then the owner decides to rent out the vineyard to some tenants and move away. Now, that's a key point all by itself. He's only rented the vineyard out. He hasn't sold it. It doesn't belong to the tenants, even though they start to act as though it does. Anyway, harvest time comes and he wants the fruit that he's been owed. So he sends his servants to go and collect it. But the tenants don't want to give the owner his dues. So they beat one servant, kill another one, and stone a third. The owner patiently sends more servants. But the tenants kill them as well. Finally, he sends his own son, thinking that they will respect his son. But instead, they kill him too, in an attempt to own the vineyard. And Jesus asks the chief priests and the elders what the landowner will do to the tenants who've acted like this. Their reply, verse 41, he will bring those wretches to a wretched end, and he will rent the vineyard to other tenants, who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time. Well, of course, why would he do anything less? Then Jesus gives the full meaning of the parable. Therefore I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit. It's all about the Jewish religious leaders. God had called and chosen his people. He'd provided for them. He'd given them a land to live in. He'd given them a way to be forgiven in the sacrificial system, and religious leaders to nurture and to grow them. And God expected fruit of people dedicated to serving him, living their lives for him, making a difference in the world, shining God's light. But instead, the system became corrupt at every level. God patiently sent prophets to call his people back over hundreds of years. Those prophets were rejected. Many of them were killed. Finally, God sent Jesus. But the majority rejected even God's own anointed king and son. He was the stone the builders rejected, and who became a stumbling block for them. And God's judgment would fall. You can see how hardened they are, that even after this chastening parable, what do they want? Are they on their knees? Are they repenting? Are they getting their sackcloth and ashes out? Not a bit of it. They just want Jesus arrested and done away with. And those leaders would be judged. In AD 70, when the whole temple and its sacrificial system was destroyed by the Roman armies, never to be reinstated. And of course, when they stand before Jesus themselves on Judgment Day. The leadership of God's people would transfer first to the apostles and then on to the Gentiles. And there is a stark warning here for us, I think. Shall we face uncertain times? Society seems to have changed so much since the pandemic. God may well be using the things that are going on to force us to ask the question, are we producing fruit for God on our watch? Or are we just in it for ourselves? Is the church just a self-perpetuating round of services and fundraisers and social events, the things we always do? Or is our priority reaching people for Jesus and helping people's faith to grow so that they can live lives of service to God? So these are really important questions. As God has promised that his church will never be overcome, but he didn't mean necessarily this church. He didn't necessarily mean the Anglican church or the Baptist church or any of the other denominations of church. He meant the people who belong to him. And if we're not being good tenants, eventually his patience will come to an end. And he will hand the responsibility on to others. And at a personal level, we will face the judgment of God. Do you know, it is stark reading. We don't really want to hear it. But we do need to hear it. Do you know, there are tax collectors and prostitutes, blind and lame, all manner of people who are stumbling through life without Jesus. And we're the ones together who have been entrusted to reach them. If we fail even to try, God will take away our privileged position. So lots to think about, and quite a challenge. Are we people who are living under the authority of Jesus? Do our lives match up to the words we say in church? And are we working hard to produce fruit for the kingdom? Doesn't mean we can't do fundraising. Of course we're to support good causes. It doesn't mean that we can't have coffee mornings and fellowship together. We need those to build one another up. But we do need to have Jesus's priorities at the forefront of our hearts and minds. So by God's grace, let us have those priorities. Let us make them our own. Word of prayer. Oh, Father God, challenging words said to the leaders of your people of old. And Lord, we saw their response. Their response was to step up the attack on Jesus, the plans to kill him, plans that we know took place only a short time later. We pray that you would give us humility when we hear challenges, that we wouldn't get angry and defensive, but that we'd hear your gentle nudges, that it would help us to trust in you, that we might know the power of your Holy Spirit in our lives, helping us, equipping us, giving us the words that we need. Oh, please, Father, give us Jesus' priorities for his kingdom. Help us to be people who are fruitful for you, who show that fruit in our own lives, but also multiply that fruit in the lives of other people who are also being changed and transformed by you. So help us, Father, to humbly hear your challenges, but then to act, to make those changes that you lay on our hearts. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.